people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. The new variant of COVID-19, Omicron, is unleashing havoc across European countries, and India and other South Asian countries don't appear to be far from a similar fate. The exponential characteristic of the Omicron transmission has already taken the number of cases over 1,000, with capital recording the most. However, to ward off a situation that strained the health system of the country and took away thousands of lives in the second wave of April and May, the authorities have come into action. Curbs are being imposed and COVID protocol being ensured. India is all set to start administrating vaccines to adolescents and booster shots to healthcare and frontline workers.
As cases of Omicron variant of coronavirus take a sharp jump in just 1 week, the Indian authorities have scrambled to contain it at all levels. Whether it is inoculating children aged between 15 and 18 or providing booster shots to elderly and frontline workers, the government has issued a new set of guidelines for the coming days. While the adolescents will start receiving their jabs from 3rd January, the precautionary boosters to the elderly and frontline workers will commence on the 10th.
15 साल से 18 साल की आयु के बीच के जो बच्चे हैं, अब उनके लिए देश में वैक्सीनेशन प्रारंभ होगा. 2022 में 3 जनवरी को सोमवार के दिन से इसकी शुरुआत की जाएगी.
The government of India has been accelerating its vaccination campaign and has now administered over 1.45 billion jabs. However, the global records that have shown a significant decline in the efficacy of vaccines against the virus have prompted the government to impose stricter preventive curbs. Mumbai and Delhi, two of the most important cities of the country, have once again been hit hard. While Maharashtra, whose capital is Mumbai, has registered most cases, the capital New Delhi is the single city to have logged the most number of cases.
जो कल 496 पॉजिटिव केसेस आए, पॉजिटिविटी लगभग 1% के आसपास चल रही है. और लगातार पिछले कुछ दिनों से, जब से ओमिक्रॉन स्टार्ट हुआ है, विदेशों से फ्लाइट्स आनी स्टार्ट हुई हैं, केसेस काफ़ी तेज़ी से बढ़ रहे हैं. अभी तक जितने भी केस आ रहे हैं, ज़्यादातर ऐसे हैं कि जो बाहर से लोग आए हैं वो थोड़े दिनों बाद पॉजिटिव हो रहे हैं, तो उनके कॉन्टैक्ट के लोग या उनके घर के लोग ज़्यादा हो रहे हैं.
The government has now been particularly cautious at handling the passengers arriving from countries identified at risk, including the United Kingdom, France and Italy. Most of the cases India has registered till now have either been foreign returnees or close contacts of those who have come from abroad. Meanwhile, the other South Asian countries too have reported the new infection. Experts say that unlike India, Pakistan, Nepal, Sri Lanka and Bangladesh have not been able to achieve their vaccination targets and are likely to struggle if the new COVID variant strikes them the way it has hit other countries. Currently, they haven't reported many cases, but the nature of the variant doesn't take much time in multiplying numbers. And with weak health systems, particularly in Pakistan and Afghanistan, even this relatively less dangerous variant could prove fatal. And from WHO to different governments, the authorities across the world have once again appealed the masks to fall in line with COVID-compliant behavior, put on their masks again, and get vaccinated.
Gilgit-Baltistan, the region under the administration of Pakistan, has been regularly reporting economic exploitation. Even after being largely responsible for meeting the needs of Pakistan, the region is barely returned the favor. Leave aside other facilities, the people in the region do not even have access to proper roads. We have a report.
The dilapidated condition of roads in illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan has become a major concern for the people. Most of the main roads in Gilgit city are in pathetic condition, with potholes at almost every yard. This has not only caused major traffic gridlocks across the city, but is also causing a huge trouble to the pedestrians. Sometimes it even leads to slippery fatal accidents. Citizens have become quite irritant owing to this overall deplorable road conditions in the city.
शर्म आना चाहिए इस डीसी और एसी को रोड की हालत ये और सीएम साहब आपसे गुजारिश है कि हफीज साहब ने इस रोड को बना के किया था और आपने इसको आपने बर्बाद करके रखा है तो शर्म आना चाहिए आपको और आप सबको
आपके साथ हादसा हो गया
हां हादसा हुआ कल को ऐसा ना हो कि यहां किसी की मौत हो तो मेरे ख्याल में इससे पहले भी यहाँ पे एक्सीडेंट हो चुके हैं तो मैं सीएम साहब और यहाँ के जो डिप्टी कमिश्नर साहब है मैं उससे गुजारिश करना चाहूँगा कि इस रोड को आप प्लीज़ प्लीज़ काइंडली ठीक करें कल को किसी की मौत ना हो
दो गिलगित बल्तिस्तान इज ब्लेस्ड विद अबंडेंस ऑफ ब्यूटी एंड कैन बी वन ऑफ द मोस्ट कैप्टिवेटिंग प्लेसेस टू विजिट ऑन अर्थ But to its dismay, neither the government nor the authorities are interested in the region's infrastructure development. The poor condition of roads is enough to hamper the tourists from visiting the region. While few roads remain blocked for weeks, many have become a death trap for the commuters due to their appalling condition. Fed up with government's laid-back attitude, at some places, the locals have themselves taken the charge and can be seen filling potholes to prevent accidents.
ये रोड का काम हुआ है तो यहाँ पे तो 100 से ज़्यादा एक्सीडेंट हो गए कोई पूछने वाला नहीं यहाँ पे ये रोड का काम हुआ है इस तरह ही पड़ा है तो इसलिए हमें बस खुद ही करना पड़ा कोई इस पर गौर नहीं कर रहे अभी खुद ही लगे हैं सर बस
क्या अपील है आप
तो सर गवर्नमेंट से हमारी अपील है कि सर इस कागज के ऊपर जल्दी से जल्दी काम किया जाए सर
As roads make a crucial contribution to economic development and growth and bring important social benefits, the countries across the world lay immense stress on road connectivity. But in illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan, proper road connectivity seems to be a distant dream. The government of the region is least interested in its development and is just worried about filling its own coffers.
Moving on, survival has become particularly challenging for Afghans with harsh winter knocking at the door. They have already been suffering due to widespread unemployment, little or no access to healthcare, medicine and food. And now the chilling winter is depriving them of even the little they have had. Let's take you to a story from Bamiyan province where the women are battling it out every single day to keep the hope alive of surviving the harshest period they have witnessed in at least two decades, which is since the Taliban takeover in August this year.
Who collects leaves and branches in autumn to her home in a cave in central province of Bamia is worried as to how she will manage food and other essentials in the freezing temperature. Food was scarce for the past few months, but it seems to be disappearing altogether from Razia's life. Stories like Razia's are increasingly common in a country struck by severe drought and where money has run dry. Before the Taliban toppled the Western-backed government in August, the economy relied heavily on foreign aid. But with the international community wary of the Islamist militant movement and the United States imposing sanctions on some of its leaders, that support has all but disappeared. The United Nations estimates nearly 23 million Afghans, about 55% of the population, are facing extreme levels of hunger, with nearly 9 million at risk of famine as winter takes hold. Life for Afghans poor has always been hard, but it is getting worse. 57-year-old Kubra is trying to find fuel to heat the single room she shares with 8 family members. The family normally lives on potatoes and a plain rice dish called shola, but the food is running short. Vegetables are now out of reach. Bamiya is best known outside Afghanistan for imposing Buddhist sites which dominate the Lil market town 20 years after the Taliban blew up the 2 giant statues that once looked down over the high plains. In winter, it is bitterly cold with temperatures that can drop below freezing and biting winds. Work slows in the cold months, but the region was already suffering since the visitors who once came for the Buddhist sites and the nearby Bande Amir Lake disappeared as the Taliban offensive reached its climax. Taliban officials say they are aware of the problems facing the poor, which they say stem partly from the effects of more than 4 decades of conflict and management under the previous government. They also have repeatedly called on Washington to unblock around $9 billion in central bank assets. And this is not the only problem that women face today in Afghanistan. Their lives that had seen hope and freedom in the previous government have been snatched away. For the past 3 months, girls over the age of 12 have been prohibited from attending school, and segregation of women and men in universities is negatively impacting women's opportunities in post-secondary institutions. Now, the recent diktat has even asked them to not travel beyond a certain distance without a male accomplice. In such times, can anybody even imagine a further decline in the situation? If not, then just wait for the Taliban's own version of liberalizing Afghan society, which essentially comes down to imposing more and more curbs on women.
And now in our section of Asia This Week, the stories from across the continent that hit the headlines this week.
Japanese automobile company Yamaha has introduced an electric three-wheeler Triton that has dual front wheels and one on the backside. It is controlled by rider's balance, who can either swipe to left or right just like skiing. With 2-hour battery charge, one can have a 30-kilometer run through this vehicle. The smooth and stable operation of Triton is enabled by a special technology of Yamaha, namely Lean Multi-Wheel or LMW technology, which is developed exclusively for motorcycles. Yamaha defines Tri-Town as last 1 mile mobility. It must be driven by aligning both legs. It brings safe and enjoyable run in the town. Yamaha's Tri-Town scooter is an innovative take on the electric scooter that aims to fix the usual electric scooter's flaws. With an aim to let students from different geographical backgrounds discuss various social issues prevailing in their countries, Aeon One Person Foundation has been working on the project, The Asian Youth Leaders, since 2010. This year, an online event of the Asian Youth Leaders was held in Tokyo, in which 72 high school students from 7 countries participated. They discussed about various topics, learned how to accept each other's values, and honed their problem-solving skills so that they can become global leaders who can take a practical action. In this first year, under the theme of creating the future of food from the perspective of reducing food losses, each participant came up with a declaration of action for reducing food losses. With the aim of realizing a sustainable society as a common global issue for next 3 years, this program is conducted under the unified theme of creating a sustainable food future that contributes to the realization of decarbonized society. Asian Youth Leader is a great initiative by Aeon One Person Club to promote friendship with foreign countries. Besides, it also enables students from different backgrounds to cultivate attitudes that are accepting global perspectives and each other's values through discussion. Vienna has once again started hosting the indirect talks between the United States and Iran, where Tehran has focused on lifting sanctions against it. Although the world hasn't witnessed the kind of control it sought vis-à-vis Iran's nuclear program. The 7th round of talks, the first under Iran's new hardline president Ebrahim Raisi, ended a few days ago after adding some new Iranian demands to a working text. Western powers said progress was too slow and negotiators had weeks, not months, left before 2015 deal becomes meaningless. Previous US President Donald Trump pulled Washington out of it in 2018, reimposing US sanctions, and Iran later breached many of deal's nuclear restrictions and kept pushing well beyond them. Iran refuses to meet directly with US officials, meaning that other parties must shuttle between the two sides. The United States has repeatedly expressed frustration at this format, saying it slows down the process, and Western officials still suspect Iran is simply playing for time. Indonesian authorities will help repair a stranded boat packed with Rohingya off its coast, but will not allow its passengers to seek refuge in Southeast Asian country and will turn the vessel away. Fishermen first spotted the skiff on last, adrift off the coast of Bairian, a district on the western island of Sumatra, with around 120 men, women and children on board. The locals said that refugees had been at the sea for 28 days and some of them had fallen ill and one had died. Indonesia is not a signatory to the 1951 UN Convention on Refugees and is predominantly seen as a transit country for those seeking asylum to a third country. Rohingya Muslim refugees from Myanmar have for years sailed to countries such as Malaysia, Thailand and Indonesia between November and April when the seas are calm.
Moving on, India recently hosted the national-level rural fair Sisir Saras Fair in its eastern Bhubaneswar city of state of Odisha. Organized every year for about 2 weeks, the fair showcases some of the best handloom and handicraft items made by the craftsmen from across the country. Have a look.
The Bhubaneswar city of Odisha put a wonderful display of exquisite products from rural India as it hosted the Sisir Saras Fair. Being a ritual and a part of Odisha's cultural calendar, the fair is organized every year by Odisha Rural Development and Marketing Society, or ORMAS. This year, around 300 stalls were set up at the fair for the artisans from across 20 states and 30 districts of Odisha. Providing a major attraction to visitors in the form of handicrafts, handlooms, jewelry, portraits and sculptors, the Sisir Saras Fair is aimed at creating market linkage of rural producers among urban consumers.
इसका जो उद्देश्य है इस पर्टिकुलर मेला का, ये ऑब्वियसली इकोनॉमिक एम्पावरमेंट है. हम लोगों के जो आर्टिजान्स हैं, हमारे जो महिला सेल्फ हेल्प ग्रुप्स हैं, जो अलग प्रोड्यूसर ग्रुप्स हैं, उन लोग साल में एक बार करीबन ऐसे फ्रॉम दी वेरियस डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स एंड वेरियस स्टेट्स, उन लोग अपना जो हैंडीक्राफ्ट प्रोडक्ट्स है, अपना जो आइटम्स है जो कि सेल करने के लिए, उन लोग यहाँ पे आते हैं. और इसलिए हम लोग ने इस बार भी उन लोगों को 300 स्टॉल्स दिया हुआ है. सो हम लोग एक्सपेक्ट करते हैं कि अच्छा बिजनेस होगा.
The fair also witnessed the participation of around 400 self-help groups, including more than 500 sellers. Artisans expressed their gratitude to the organizers for putting up such an exhibition, as for the last 2 years, they were not able to sell their products due to COVID-19.
हम कोरोना के टाइम हम गांव में नहीं बेचने की कोई सुविधा नहीं मिला था. तो ये शिशिर सारस हुआ भुवनेश्वर में, हमको बुलाए हैं. हम ये मिट्टी का सामान लेकर बेचने के लिए आए हैं. 2 साल तो बैठ कर रहे थे. ये उर्मास जो किया तो हमको अच्छा लगा और हम भी बेच के घर के जाएंगे.
The fair not only left visitors spoiled for choice, but also provided them an opportunity to meet the faces behind the meticulously made products. They were delighted to see such a vast range of products with the latest designs, quality and versatility.
हम हर एक साल आते हैं घूमने के लिए और इस साल बहुत अच्छा है. थोड़ा इनोवेशन लाए हैं, जैसे हम लोग ऑनलाइन में देखते हैं थोड़ा थोड़ा न्यू डिज़ाइन और फिनिशिंग के साथ आए हैं और बहुत अच्छे अच्छे आइटम के साथ आए हैं. थोड़ा न्यू कुछ इनोवेशन डाले हैं जो लोगों को टच करेगा. बहुत अच्छा है, बहुत अच्छा इनिशिएटिव है जो गांव में बनाते हैं जो लोग, जो हाथों से बनाते हैं क्राफ्ट, और उसको लाकर हम लोगों के पास लाना, जिन्हें लोगों के पास, वही हम लोगों के लिए एक अपॉर्चुनिटी है कि जो इंडिया के हाथों से बना हुआ चीज़ हमें मिलता है.
By providing an opportunity to artisans to sell their products as well as create market linkages, Sisir Saras Fair has turned out successful in creating a niche for its own.
If you want to have a peek into India's countryside, then Sisir Saras should be your destination. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.